And unlike the second group, it isn't about potential. Today's guest is the most winning long-distance race car driver in the world. Let that roll around in your brain for a little bit. The most winning long-distance race car driver in the world. So the question then is, how do you become the best at the hardest type of racing possible? Are you the fastest? Are you the most aggressive driver? Or do you just do the easy thing, hire a couple of hitmen, and just get your competition out of there? Well, I know only a couple of you guys have been to the show here before, but one thing we've learned over the past with all of our guests, there's always something we learn about life. We come away, we know we definitely talk about cars here, and today we're going to talk about cars, we're going to talk about cool cars, we're going to talk about racing. But today we're going to get probably the most profound lesson on life. We're going to get, I don't want to sound too much like Oprah, but we're going to learn about how to be consistently successful. So I would suggest getting your notebooks out, getting your pens out, and welcome, join me in welcoming the Porsche legend and, of course, the most winning long-distance race car driver in the world, Mr. Hurley Haywood. Yeah. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, George.
Really good to see you. Let me give you your mic here. We're trying something a little bit new with a mic today, so hopefully you guys can hear us in Cyberland. Welcome, Hurley.
Well, good to be here.
Well, I'm very glad to have you here. You know, we've known each other now for a couple of years, haven't we?
Yep. I think I first met you in Birmingham in that masterful job of heel and toeing.
Yes. Yeah. Well, we'll get to that. Yeah. We're going to cover that. But it started, it didn't start on racetracks. It didn't even start in Jacksonville, where you live now. It started in Illinois. Tell us about where you came from.
Well, I was born in Chicago, and my parents had a house right in downtown Chicago, right off of Lakeshore Drive. And luckily, of course, you know, that's not really too conducive to a kid driving around on roads in a very busy city like Chicago. But we had five working farms out west of the city. And the main farm, which is where this picture was taken, was my grandmother's estate. So it allowed me the opportunity at a pretty young age to explore driving a car. Now, I had go-karts and stuff when I was, you know, 6 or 7 years old, but I started driving a full-size car when I was 12 years old.
And what was that?
That was a 1948 Studebaker truck.
But and, you had a hard time reaching the pedals?
Yeah, our farm foreman made some blocks for the pedals, made me a special seat so I could, you know, see out of the windshield. It was a 3-speed transmission, you know, on the floor. And I started driving that car, and my parents didn't really know about it. We kind of kept it a secret. So I probably drove that car around without getting caught for about a year and a half. And suddenly I was going pretty fast on one of the drives and met my father returning from work. and the gig was up, but it was pretty wonderful because you know, being on a farm, you drive in all kinds of different road conditions. You drive on pavement, you drive on dirt, you drive on grass, you drive on sand, you drive where there's no roads at all. So it was a very unique experience for me.
Now, speaking of unique, you talked about your father, but your grandfather had, or I don't want to say created, but invented something very unique that we now all use today.
Yeah, he was a pretty ingenious guy. I'm sure my parents wished I followed in the footsteps of him, but he was...
They don't like this deadbeat racing thing? It's going nowhere.
They're not keen on the racing part. But he invented the principles of the pneumatic, agitation system for the washing machines, and he also invented the principles of the pneumatic tool. His company was called Thorpe power tool. His father was actually the one that came up with the agitation system, and then when he took over, my grandfather took over the company, they developed that into the, you know, everyday washing machines that everybody used back then. So it obviously allowed my childhood and my growing up to be one that was, my parents had a very, really were very strict with us, and as far as not being, allowing us to be too excessive as kids. And so we had to really work for everything that we did and got, but there was a lot to be gotten, and it was, I'm blessed to be allowed to have that privilege.
And it wasn't just you, you had some siblings?
Yeah, I had a brother and a sister. My brother is the youngest, my sister's the middle, and I'm the oldest.
Now, exposure, I mean, if you're growing up in Chicago, pretty metropolitan city, but then you have this opportunity to go to the farms and drive, but did your family, did you guys travel at all? Did you get to see anything beyond Chicago?
Yeah, my grandmother was, she really wanted us to see the world, and we did a lot of traveling to Europe, and I think as a kid, you know, and I can remember going over on the Queen Mary to Europe, that allows you to see things that you really don't register as a kid, but as you start to grow up, you start to appreciate those things. And they were, you know, big into all of the arts, getting an education that not only gave you the opportunity to, you know, make a living from being a lawyer or a doctor or something like that, but also to give you an appreciation from what's around you, from the environment, from the conservative side, to the arts. So all of those things were wrapped into a really nice package. Nothing was too overdone. We sort of were allowed to absorb it at the rate that we were able to appreciate it.
So was that your first time away from home, specifically on your own?
Well, you know, we were good kids, but my parents wanted all of us to be educated the right way. So basically, their mind was to send us away to boarding school. I went away to boarding school when I was in seventh grade at a place called Fessenden, which is outside of Boston. And it's a very famous school. A lot of, you know, very famous people have graduated from that school. And then after that was done, I went to prep school in Vermont. And you can imagine that being subjected to the winters of Chicago, the winters of Vermont, and the winters of Boston, that by the time I hit college, I was ready to get into some warm climates.
So you're away from the farm and driving the Studebaker and farm equipment for most of the year if you're going to boarding school. What was the, was there a car fascination? Did it start before you went to boarding school or at boarding school? Did you support it at all?
Well, I loved cars. I mean, that was something that I devoted a lot of my time and attention to and dreamed about a lot as a kid. But I really didn't put the racing part together. I liked fast cars, I liked speed, but I didn't really equate any of that to what I would do on a racetrack or in a racing environment. Or in my wildest imagination, I never dreamed that I could make a living by being a racing driver. This was just not part of my thinking at that point.
And was, like a lot of us in the room, how many guys or women, there's car girls in here as well, how many of you kind of got the car disease from your parents? Raise your hand. I know you guys did. Yeah, a lot of them. Basically this half of the room, not this half of the room. That's interesting. I've never seen that before. Was your dad or grandfather into cars? Did they drive cool cars?
No, they liked nice cars. They always had really cool cars to drive, but they didn't. There was no connection to the racing part of it. So they drove cool cars. They liked, you know, sports cars. They liked, you know, cool cars back in that day. I mean, my grandmother had a gullwing Mercedes that she drove.
Wow.
And she drove that car until she was in her 70s.
You told me your father drove Oldsmobiles. He never mentioned the Mercedes.
He never asked about my grandmother.
Well, with that, does everybody want to see Hurley's first car? You want a picture of Hurley's first car? I think we should see Hurley's first car.
Yeah,
we're going way back here.
Yeah.
Really, what was your first car?
The first car I had was a Buick.
Wouldn't you really rather have a Buick?
Yeah, I can't really remember. It was sort of a late 50s, I think, and I was at the lot, and it had twin exhaust pipes, and I said, that's kind of cool, and so I saved my money from working on the farm, and I had $300, and I went down, and I bought this car, and cut the exhaust pipes off, so I had a splitter, so it had straight exhaust, and that was, and I used to take it to the auto, drag strip, and it was always a joke at the drag strip when I would arrive, because they had a nickname for it, which I can't really remember what that nickname was, but it was not a very
It was not the most winning long-distance race car driver in the world?
No. But that, we upgraded considerably from...
Okay. Speaking of upgrades, you went off to Jacksonville University, and has anybody heard of Baldwin Motion? I know there's a Chevy guy over there. Baldwin Motion, Chevy, that kind of stuff. Well, it turns out there was something else, and Hurley bought it.
Yeah, that was the car that started it all, actually, a Corvette. And I'll give you a little back history to why I was able to get this car. When I graduated from high school, my parents were so thrilled that I made it through high school.
So you weren't a stellar student?
And no. And so...
So you didn't have that title. Yeah, okay.
I was, I really wanted a motorcycle, so I got a 650 Bonneville motorcycle, and I just loved that bike. It was fast, it was agile, it was really cool. I could, you know, bomb around in the city, I could take it on country roads, it was really cool. Literally weeks after I got that motorcycle, my mother started to read all these horrible stories in the newspaper about how dangerous motorcycles were. So she came to me and she said, you know, the motorcycle has got to go. You've got to get rid of that. I want you to sell it right away. So I said, well, Mom, you know, I'm used to this kind of performance. The car I get has got to be kind of along that line. So she said, okay, we'll go out and look around to see what you can find. So I happened to be driving down a dealership called Nikki Chevrolet in Chicago. It was a world-renowned speed-related dealership. And this car was sitting on the front lawn, and I went in and looked at it. It was used. It had 4,000 miles on it. They wanted to sell it right away. I drove it. It was totally cool. And I said, okay, I'm going to bring my... I waited till my father was out of town, and I said, I'm going to bring my mother down and let her look at it. So I said, but under no circumstances do we take a test drive or do we start it, because it was thunderous when it was just idling. And so anyway, she saw it. She said, oh, that's really cute. Get it? So anyway,
This is cute.
That was cute.
Okay, what's cute here, notice there's two little cats. This is Hurley's girlfriend at the time. He's got the two little white cats with his cute car.
Yeah, that was at the farm. And that was Kathy Vogel. She was the daughter of Sonny Vogel, who actually used to run the Brumos organization. He was a general manager of the Porsche Mercedes-Benz store.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Amazing how this ties in.
And her brother, Mike, was the one that was my crew chief when I started racing in the early days, in 1969. So he and his father kind of helped with, and Peter, of course, and some of the Brumos mechanics helped with that whole initial racing.
Now, there's something unique about this car that stands out, that people could tell that this is not a normal Corvette. Is there anything unique about this car?
Yeah, the license plate.
Well, not the license plate, but yeah. Think about if you're a Corvette guy, how many taillights are on a Corvette normally?
Two.
Exactly. Yeah. This is the Porsche guy. Yeah.
The Nikki Chevrolet's their signature was three tailpipes or three taillights.
So you decide to go off to Florida University or Jacksonville University in Florida with this car, which I could imagine a 400 horsepower car?
500.
I'm leaving some on the table here. 500 horsepower car in university. I gather your scholastic reputation didn't excel at that point?
No. Not even close. It was, probably not the smartest thing in the world to bring that car to college because very quickly after I arrived in Jacksonville, the local Corvette group got a hold of me and they said, "Oh, you got to try it out on some of these autocrosses." And I was really good at autocross, and this car was a perfect autocross car. Tons of torque, pretty good grip, and so I was basically pretty much unbeatable in the whole state of Florida. And the reputation of that car was kind of legendary. I mean, that thing, when I would roll into an autocross, they would all go, "Oh God, he's back." So
no more nicknames with the Buick.
No more nicknames. And that car actually helped me when I first met Peter Gregg. Peter came to an autocross in a Winn-Dixie parking lot in Jacksonville. And he arrived there with his full crew, with the race truck, the race car in the truck. Everybody's in uniform, slick deal. I didn't know who the hell Peter Gregg was from a hole in the wall at that point. And we happened to tie for the fastest time of the day. And we had a runoff, and I beat him. And he came up and said, you got to be pretty good to beat me. And away the friendship went. I sort of talked to him about racing. I went with him and worked on the crew. I went to college in 1967, so 68 and 69, and the tail part of 67, I guess. And I just fell in love with the whole thing. So, he said, "Well, I will help you order your first race car, but how are you going to pay for this?" And I said, "Well, I can't do it myself. I'm going to have to get my parents to cooperate on this." So I made this really beautiful, slick proposal to my father. And I went up and I said, "Dad, this is kind of what I want to do." And he knew that he was a smart enough guy that he knew that if this wasn't addressed right then, that this was going to be an itch that was going to be going out of control for a long time. So in the proposal, I said, we came up with an amount, which included the cost of a brand new Porsche race car. And I made a deal that I would pay him back, if I was successful, that I would pay him back a certain amount every year going forward. But he gave me a 2-year window, and he said, "If you're not successful after 2 years to continue on your own at this level that you're at right now, you have to stop and do something more responsible." So I said, "Okay." And I figured, well, the last thing in my imagination at that point was that I would be successful. And I'll have 2 years of having a good time racing a cool race car, and then I'll go be a lawyer or a doctor.
So just for the avoidance of doubt, you come up with a presentation to pitch to your father. Who is the one telling you need a 911 to do this?
Peter, yeah.
He works where at this time?
He owned Brumos.
Which is a Porsche dealer.
Yep. Yeah. And actually, Peter's racing career started in a Corvette. Also, he was a Harvard graduate. He had a Corvette that he raced around, basically in the same kind of stuff that I started. But when I met him, one of the first things that he told me was, if you want to have a successful winning career, you will get rid of that Corvette and you'll buy a Porsche. And his whole, you know, his whole reputation at that point, he had already started gaining his reputation as a racing driver, won a couple championships. He said, we can parlay this into something that's good. So I ordered my first race car. He actually ordered the car from the factory. It was delivered in Jacksonville. He said, I will go up to Savannah, and I'll teach you how to drive it in Savannah.
Roebling Road?
Roebling Road, yep. And we went up there, and after the first day, I was quicker than he was. So he said, okay.
Sure, he loved that.
Yeah. Well, no, this was a business for him, and he thought that, you know, I'll be able to capitalize on this kid. You know, he's a novice. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's got some, obviously, he's got talent, but I'll hone that talent into making him become a good racing driver. And away we went.
And when did you get a racing license?
I got a racing license. I started racing on my birthday, which was May 4th. And that was when I was 21 years old. You couldn't get your license until you were 21. And that was in May. So that was a regional license back then. Those of you that are mm-hmm. know the SCCA, they issued you a regional license. Then you waited for a while. Then you were able to get a national license. Mm-hmm. And then you could get your pro license. Peter said, we don't have enough time for that kind of stuff. We're going to get you a grand national license in the mail from NASCAR. And when you get that, it was $20 back then. When you get that, then we'll apply to the FIA to get you an FIA license. Because I want a race with you at the 6 hours of Watkins Glen, which was a world championship race. I'm going, what am I getting myself into?
So you go from a Buick Century to a Corvette to a NASCAR race car driver, and now a Porsche.
Yeah, well, never a NASCAR. But I had the license, which enabled me to get the FIA license, which I needed. So I went to Watkins Glen. I'm a complete, total novice. They had the 512s, the 917 coupes, the Matras. They had everything there. Super fast cars, prototypes. I'm in a 911. I mean, I remember the Matra coming down the back straight. And that's before they had that chicane, so you were, you know, well over 200 miles an hour in the prototypes. And the sound that Matra, I mean, literally I had to almost rip my helmet out and put my ears, my fingers in my ears. It was so noisy, and so, you know, the vibration sound and the echo from that car was just incredible. But we, Peter and I won the race. We won our division, which the whole GT division, which included beating the Corvettes and the Camaros and Mustangs and all of a sudden. So that was my first professional win, which was Watkins Glen in 1969.
Big round of applause for that. At 21 years old. Now, normally when someone has a huge milestone like that in life, they go to Disneyland, right? You went somewhere else.
Yeah. I should have worked harder when I was in college, because back then this was when the lottery was introduced, and I got myself drafted into the Army. I went to Fort Leonard Wood for boot camp, and then I was on Tiger Airlines going over to Vietnam at the end of 1969. And, you know, that was... It's hard to really describe what that was like, but I really take that time that I was in Vietnam and the whole learning curve. When I came back to the States, that allowed me to be in a position to have the right kind of mindset to be a successful racing driver. Because in Vietnam, when you're getting shot at, you have a tendency to very quickly grow up. And it was, for me, it was something that I was just a 180-degree turn from what I was used to. So it required me to concentrate. It was, you know, you had to be very disciplined. You had to, you know, keep your head up and be always on the lookout for bad things. And I think it when I look back on it now, I think that training from an early state, not in a race car, but just in the whole experience of living, really, really helped me in being a racing driver.
So you talk about it, your life literally changed. So you go from this protected life to what was it like when you landed in Vietnam? What was specifically going on when you guys got off that plane?
Well, you know, Tiger Airlines was kind of one of the airlines that used to fly the troops over to Vietnam. And, you know, those, I don't know what they were back then. They were big airplanes. They were able to get, you know, a couple hundred soldiers in there sitting shoulder to shoulder. We made a night landing, and the pilot said, you know, we've got some problems on the ground. We're going to be turning all the lights off. We're going to make a dark landing. And we landed, and basically, you know, we could hear artillery shells coming into the airfield that we had landed on, and they basically dropped our luggage out of the chute from the back and then ushered us out, and they took us and they put us in these drainage ditches and waited till the artillery shells had stopped coming in. All the while, the jets got its engines running, and they moved that to a more secure place. They, you know, the troops don't mean anything. We need to protect the airplane. And so that was my first introduction to Vietnam. And I'm going, it was so mind-boggling. I couldn't comprehend what that year was going to be like. But luckily, it kind of worked out. My mother, of course, was totally freaked out, and so she suddenly became the civilian head of the USO. And by being in that position, I sort of got my name into the hat to be a colonel's aide. He was the airfield commander in Can Tho, which was the base that we were at. And I started working for him, and we were responsible for all the base operations, including the airfield. We had about 5,000 people on our base. So it was a good job to be in, but, you know, he was a pretty gung-ho, so I'd have to fly with him in his helicopter a lot. So we did get, you know, into some kind of scary deals, but it was a good experience.
So what's it like going from, you know, you're this guy driving this 500-horsepower custom Chevy to this now race-prepped Porsche? I mean, basically, you kind of dictating your own life, and now you're in the military and someone's dictating orders to you. How is that? How do you adapt to that?
You follow orders. And when I came back to the States, Peter was, you know, Peter's nickname was Peter Perfect. And he got that nickname by being perfect in everything that he did. He was a perfect team owner. He was a perfect coach. And he expected me to obey what he was telling me, to do what he was telling me to do without questioning it. And it all worked out. I mean, it was, you know, really great training. He taught me a lot of the sort of the philosophical part of driving. He knew that I had the actual, you know, talent to drive the race car, but you know, you can't teach somebody how to, you can teach somebody how to drive a race car, but you can't teach somebody how to be a racing driver. And those were the things that sort of he taught me how to do, how to analyze where you needed to get an advantage, how you were able to take an advantage of a situation that might occur. And those kind of things are done in a flash, in a split second. You don't have the luxury of being able to sit and analyze a problem and run it off of a board of directors. You have to make these decisions all the time. and they have to be split-second decisions, and sometimes those are like, you know, life and death. So you learn that you have to analyze a problem and you have to react to that problem instantaneously. And those are some of the things that Peter was able to teach me, and those were some of the things that I was able to bring back from the Vietnam experience to help me get that done.
Did I not promise you life lessons today? So you're back in 1971, and you go right back to Jacksonville, and you go right back to Brumos. So what did you guys start doing? And oh, by the way, before we move on, Peter Perfect, was he military?
He was a naval officer. And a lot of people say, well, first, where did Brumos come from? That's kind of a weird name. And where did 59 come from? And where did the font of 59 come from? Well, Brumos is the cable address for Brundage Motors. Herbert Brundage was killed in a motorcycle accident in 1965, and Peter bought Brumos from the Brundage family. And Brundage was the cable address for Brumos. So that's how Brumos came about. Peter liked the way that sounded, so he kept it. Peter was a naval officer, and he one day was flying in a fixed-wing aircraft out to an aircraft carrier, and they were circling it, and Peter noticed that on the bow and the stern of the boat was the number 59, and it was done in the font of the 59 that's on our race car. So that's how that all came about, and that number and that font is pretty legendary.
Tell us a little bit about the relationship you had with Peter, getting along with him.
Peter was a very difficult person. He 90% of the time he was just a great person, a lot of fun to be around, and then 10% it was the dark side. And so to be a friend of Peter, you had to accept that dark side, because you knew it wasn't permanent. It was something that was not going to last very long. I can remember on many occasions, you know, him getting mad at me for doing something and throwing me out of his office, or you know, not allowing me on the premises of Brumos, you know, just all kinds of stuff. But, you know, you went back in an hour and you went to lunch with him. So it was not something that I really took too personally. And that was, you know, if you were going to be a friend of Peter's, and Peter didn't have very many friends, those were the, you know, that was part of the program of dealing with him.
But at the time, you're still a much younger driver than most people on the grid. How did you deal with that? How do you compete when you are so much younger?
Well, I didn't personally look at it as an age thing. I looked at it as being able to maybe capitalize on my age to make that work for me. And when you take youth and the enthusiasm of youth and the endurance of youth, and you couple that to being mature behind the wheel of a racing car, you've got a combination that's hard to beat. And Peter saw that. He quickly developed those traits in me. And so Peter and I were Batman and Robin, and it was something that really worked, and it was something that worked psychologically with the competition. When we would roll into a racetrack, I remember Peter, this is before, you know, speed limits were in the pit lane, and he said, when you leave the pit lane, I want you at red line, full blast going out of here, because when you go by the competition, that's going to demoralize them. You know, God, those guys are flying in the pits. What are they going to be like on the racetrack? So it was just a mindset of how he always was working mind games with everybody.
But it seemed to work. You guys went out, and now you're back from the military, and you're winning.
Yep.
You guys won a lot. So what kind of stuff did you compete in, and what did you guys win?
Well, the first race that I was in with Peter when I came back from Vietnam, and I was sort of closing my career, being I was at Fort Leonard Wood, and Peter and I raced at VIR, and that was it was the first IMSA race at VIR, and we won it. And of course, the next day in the
local, this was your first race back from the military.
Back from the military, and you know, you had to, didn't really give me too much time to get warmed up again. We were just kind of thrown into the competition, but it was something that all worked out perfect. Well, the following day, our picture was on the front page of the military newspaper, and I got a call from the commanding officer going, what is this? And so anyway, he was a good guy, and they sort of accelerated the you know, the process of getting out of the Army at that point.
You also had some other royalty, I would say, in racing that you worked with. Who were some of the other people?
At that point, you mean?
At that point, yeah.
Well, you know, I sort of to backtrack a little bit, I started in 71, so we won back-to-back IMSA championships in 71 and 72. So 71 was a championship that I shared with Peter, and then in 72, Peter went to run in the Can-Am, and he gave me the responsibilities of racing in the GT car. And then the Can-Am scared Peter to death, so he said, I want to get out of that, you know, kind of like the old ad on television, and let Mikey try it, but we'll sell the car to Hurley. So that was the second car that I owned, and that was a huge jump going from a 300 horsepower 911 into a 1200 horsepower Can-Am car, racing against that level of drivers. In the beginning of 73, which is the year I started the Can-Am series, Peter, Greg, and Roger Penske were given factory RSRs to race. So Roger had Mark Donahue and George Fulmer driving their car, and Peter and myself were in our car. And during that time, I became friendly with Mark. I had actually met Mark several years before that, when Peter was racing for Bud Moore with the Mustangs. And this was before I started racing. And Peter would send me out as a scout to find out what the tire compounds were on the other teams, thinking that they, you know, wouldn't know who I was. Well, Peter and I kind of looked alike, so everybody figured, you know, that's Peter's brother, so get him out of here. So so that didn't last for very long. But I had met Mark, and then when I started in 73 in the Can-Am, this was a car that I had a huge adjustment to make. And Mark was really very instrumental in helping me adapt to that car, and it was a successful endeavor, because I was third in the championship behind Mark and George Fulmer, and then I was third.
So I want to, let's cut to the chase a little bit here. So how many times have you won Le Mans?
Three.
Tell me the years. A round of applause for this.
In 1977, uh-huh. 83, and 94.
Okay. As amazing as an accomplishment as it is to win Le Mans three times, Hurley did it in three separate decades. That requires a big round of applause. And then, of course, there's Daytona, too. And you, like, collected that one like other people collect stamps. How many times did you win Daytona?
Five
times, yeah. So there's a whole theme with this most winning long distance race car.
Two at Sebring, too. So
two, I'm sorry, I forgot about Sebring.
That's what they count as the classics in racing, which is Daytona, Le Mans, and Sebring. And I've won, you know, 9 Watkins Glen races, too, but Watkins Glen is in that mix. And they said, well, you know, that's 10 races, but, you know, Tom Christensen has won 9 Le Mans races. And so wouldn't you call him the world's best? And the general consensus is, well, Tom has never raced at Daytona and has never raced at Sebring. And Tom really, though he's an incredible racing driver, back in the wins other than this year, they were all against, you know, fellow teammates in Audis. So he really didn't have a lot of competition other than his teammates at Audis. So I can kind of defend that as the master of the endurance classics by pointing out that, you know, it's one thing to win a whole bunch of races at one racetrack, but to win it at multiple racetracks is a kind of different deal.
Now, there is another racetrack which you had certain victories on that most people don't know about.
Yeah, the local go-kart track in Jacksonville. You know, this was when I was, you know, still pretty young. I was probably my mid-20s when this was taken. And back then, we used to have the Antiques Drinking Society and Greater Jacksonville Go-Kart Racing Society. And it was compromised by about, I don't know, 15 guys. And every Tuesday, we would go to the local go-kart track, get in cars, and absolutely have a ton of fun. We would, you know, throw water on the track, gasoline, light the
gasoline
on fire. Yeah, I mean, it was just nuts. And we had, you know, judges. I mean, we had everybody as part of this group. And then after the racing was over, we would jump in our cars, drive as fast as we could go to Antiques, which was a local bar in Jacksonville. And they had made concoctions like the famous 59, which was this lethal drink. And everybody would get, you know, totally drunk and then get in their cars and drive home. And it was before, you know, before all of the problems with, you know, drunken driving and all that kind of stuff, but we all managed to make it through.
We got to re-examine this Taco Tuesday thing we do here in California, because that doesn't, I mean, this Florida thing is good.
Jesus.
So what is this? This is a specific time in your life.
Yeah, that was, did I send you that picture?
Unless I made these myself on
that
Photoshop.
That was being interviewed by the head of one of the news stations in Jacksonville on my return from Le Mans in 1977. They had a huge group of people at the airport when I came off the plane, and then the next day, this was at the dealership. So they had a big, huge party at the dealership, and that was in the old Brumos showroom on Atlantic Boulevard. That showroom now is a Mercedes-Benz showroom, and we have a new building across the street, but that was pretty cool.
It's kind of like the Beatles landing at JFK in 64.
Yeah,
right?
Well, not exactly, but...
And what car is this?
That was the car that was crafted that allowed me to win my third Le Mans run. There was a guy, Jochen Dauer, who took a basic 962 and made a street car out of it. They were just crazy fast. They were like a race car. I mean, they were 962, but a street car. And Norbert Singer, who was the famous legendary engineer at Porsche, which crafted all of these concept cars, the 935, the 936, the 962, the 911 RSs were all crafted by Norbert Singer. So he found a hole in the rule book that allowed us to race this car in GT, in the GT class at Le Mans. And he took the car to Weissach, put it in the wind tunnel. Basically, you had to close the floor off because it was a ground effects car. And it created some pretty unique challenges as far as the aerodynamics. When you took away the ground effects, you had to create the downforce somewhere, but you didn't want to create too much downforce at a place like Le Mans because Le Mans was so critical to top speed. So they made the perfect venue, and this car was a ton of fun to drive. It was more like driving the 936, which was the open cockpit car with the snout above the driver. You know, you could wail it through a corner, you could slide it, you could use the power. I mean, it was really a lot of fun. And originally, the driving pairing was myself with Stuck and Bootsen, and Sullivan was going to drive with Yannick Damas and Mauro Baldi, who are the two guys that are standing next to me. And after this test was done at Paul Ricard prior to the 24-hour race at Le Mans, Mauro and Yannick went to the factory and had a seat made just for them. So obviously you can look at Danny and say, you know, Danny's a lot bigger than they are. And so when we got to Le Mans, it was very quickly realized that Danny wasn't going to sit in their seat. So the decision was made to move me over to their car and Sullivan over to Stuck's car. And we went on to win it, so that was lucky for me. And that was one of the few times ever that I had driven in a car where the seat fit properly. Usually, you know, when you're driving with multiple guys, there's always guys like Stuck who, you know, are really big, so the seat is basically their seat, and we have to put in, you know, boosters and, you know, pads and stuff to accommodate the smaller frames, and that is just a nightmare when you're trying to deal with that. So it was.
Now you, someone you knew had an interesting quote about you before the whole most winning long distance race car driver in the world. Something about a bad race car. Not that this one was a bad race car.
Yeah, Al Hobart, who I had a huge amount of respect for, was a great guy. He once told me that I could drive a bad race car faster than anybody that he knew. And I took that as a compliment, because what that means is that I was able to accept what the downfalls of that given car was and capitalize on its strong points that were left. And I'm so often asked, you know, why do you think that you're such a successful racing driver? And one of the things I think is important for a racing driver is his ability to adapt to change. And I know so many guys that only can drive race cars when they're absolutely perfect. And they're usually really good qualifiers because the car is tuned just to them to make those couple qualifying laps. But they can't, once that car gets out of that sort of perfect window, they can't drive it anymore. Or they're much slower with the car. But I just look at it, it is what it is. You've got to deal with it. You've got to try to capitalize on making it as fast as it was when you thought it was perfect. And you would be surprised at how often when you do have a car that's, you know, been banged and the suspension bent and, you know, any hundreds of things that can go wrong with a race car, how if you just drive around that problem, how fast you can actually be. And that's what Al saw. Al saw that you are really good at adapting to changes. And when you take that kind of attitude and you put that into a racing scenario, your race window is filled with changes. You start the race in a perfect car as humanly possible. And then the minute that car starts to move, it starts to go downhill. your tires get hot, your engine gets hot, your brakes get hot, the track gets slippery. There's all sorts of scenarios that are happening on the race car as far as traffic goes. When you adapt to that stuff and you sort of pick your windows of opportunity out, you can, you know, really be good. And I think that that was one of the fundamental reasons why I was successful. I'm not that fast a racing driver. I'm a little bit too conservative sometimes, but by being conservative, I sort of wait until save the best for last and let the guys wear themselves out at the beginning, and then I know that I've got a good car to make a really serious attack at the end, and it works.
Are we all ready to go and change our lives now? Who is this?
That is Judy Stropas. Judy, most of you probably don't know Judy, but Judy, before computers and, you know, digital timing and all that stuff, she used to keep our lap charts for us, and she would write down every single car in a race. So, you know, like a Daytona 24-hour race back in the 70s and 80s, we used to start that race with, you know, 75 cars. And she would keep track of all those 75 cars for 24 hours without moving from her stand. She used to work for Roger Penske at the 500, at the Indy 500. She's a wonderful person, and she basically ran our PR team when we were racing in the Can-Am, and also did all of our time in scoring for us until computers took over.
Relaxation here?
Yeah, that was in Europe. I won't tell you the story behind that, but we'll let that pass.
And so here's your Can-Am car?
Yeah, that's the Can-Am car. That was that's Vasek Polak, who is...
out here?
Yeah. Vasek was a dear friend. We raced against him. He had Jody Scheckter driving for his team in 73, and I became close to Vasek in 73, and then in 74 the SCCA changed the rules and basically obsoleted our cars. So I was looking at a very expensive car that was suddenly worth nothing in my time frame.
And for the avoidance of doubt, you own some of these cars.
Yeah, I own two cars. I own. First was the 911 that I had, and second was this car. So I, Vasek came and said, "I will buy your car from you," and I said, "That's great." And he was going to offer me basically half of what I paid for it, which I said okay. That I figured I'd cut my losses in half. I think I threw in a set of spare wheels, I think. And so off he went, and it went to his showroom, and it sat in the corner of his showroom in Hermosa Beach from 1974 to 1991. And in 1991, we bought it back from him for considerably more than he bought it for me. But...
Sounds like he was a very good dealer.
He was a great car dealer. But that car, the sister to that car, which was George Fulmer's car, sold last year at Pebble for $5.6 million. So it was if I had just been smart enough to hold on to that car, I'd been in good shape.
I think all of us have stories about cars we sold we definitely want back. So tell us a little bit about the rigors of endurance racing, of 24-hour racing. How is it different than other type of racing? Besides the Mountain Dew in the picture, notice that's Mountain Dew there.
I don't know. You know, when you talk about a long distance race, I once said that it's trying to find where the window is between destroying your car and getting your car to the finish line after 24 hours. And there's a certain amount. You want to drive at 100% of 90%. So you want to leave 10% on the table. And that 10%, usually in the old days, was enough to save the car and get you to the end of the race without any mechanical problems. You have to not only be mechanically sensitive to the car, but you also have to avoid, you know, the obvious contact on the racetrack, making stupid moves on the racetrack. And those were all things that I was really good at doing. I was very good with being gentle with the car, yet not affecting the lap time. Lap time was still fast, but I was able to bring the car back in one piece in good operating order without having dents and, you know, mechanical issues with the car. And so that I think is one of the big things about being successful is you've got to be patient. You've got to wait for windows of opportunity to arise, and when they do arise, you've got to pounce on them. I mean, that's the kind of the thing about the instant reaction. You've always got to, you never can lose concentration of what you're doing. Everybody said, well, how can you be concentrating like that for such long periods of time? And those times are anywhere from, you know, 1 hour in the car to, you know, 3 hours, 4 hours is the maximum. The most I ever spent behind the wheel of a race car was an 8 hour shift at night in 1977 when we won. But, you know, it was, it's different. Today's racing is much different than it was in the 80s and 90s. The cars are much more complicated. And it was a challenge. When I retired from the driving seat in 2012, I still keep my hand in the seat of a race car. I still drive a race car on a regular basis, but I just don't race. But I listen, and when I retired, I took over from running and being responsible for our drivers, which were Andrew Davis and Lee Keen, two very different personalities. One is an A personality, one is a B personality. Size difference, kind of like Hans Stuck and Hurley Haywood together. Andrew's more my size, Lee is more Hans Stuck's size. But the combination of those two guys together was magical. They really clicked, and they were able to take their strong points and make it work to their advantage. So it was a really good relationship. And I really enjoyed doing that. I enjoyed the challenge of using my knowledge to help younger guys sort of get that same advantage that Peter gave me. So,
and who are you helping today?
I'm helping Patrick Dempsey, which Patrick is a great guy. He's super, super for the product. He's passionate about racing. He's been racing for a long time. But with Patrick, it's a real challenge, because racing isn't just his, you know, isn't his only thing that he does to make a living. He doesn't make
a
living.
He does something else?
Yeah.
What else does he do?
Famous actor. So when he gets to the racetrack, he's got a million things on his mind. So it's my job to get him channeled in a very, you know, short time frame, and to get him looking at a few points. He takes direction really good. He's made a huge progress in his driving. He doesn't make mistakes. And not only have I been working on Patrick, but we've been also working on the structure of how the team works. You can be the greatest driver in the world, but if you don't have a good team behind you, you're just not gonna, you know, go anywhere. So Patrick doesn't have the knowledge on how to craft a winning team. You can have a racing team, which is great, but you have to be able to be successful, have a winning racing team, and have the attitude that those guys have focused on winning, not just racing. Have to focus on winning, and winning is, as we all know, hard to do. So my job is not only to work with Patrick, but also to work with the team, and I'm really expecting us when we get to the Petit, which is the last race of the season, that we're going to get some really good results.
And just as a point of reference, so we talked about some of the stuff you can control as the team owner or the driver. Of 100% of the teams that, say, start Le Mans or Daytona, how many actually finish?
Well, a lot more teams finish at Le Mans. Sort of, I think the level of preparation is a little bit higher at Le Mans. Usually at Daytona, if you start a field of 70 cars, you're lucky if 35, half of them finish. Where at Le Mans, I think it's closer, you know, to maybe 80 or 90% of them finish. So, you know, that's one of the, I'm often asked the question, you know, which is more difficult to win, Daytona or Le Mans? And I always say Daytona, and they kind of look at me and they, you know, that's kind of weird. Why? Well, it's easy. Number one, at Daytona, you've got at least 12 hours of nighttime. At Le Mans, you have maybe 5 hours. So your window of nighttime driving is reduced. Now, sure, you do have lights at Daytona now, but in the old days, you didn't have the lights. You know, lights are only, you know, the last 10 years. And Daytona has a huge variance of driver performance. You have really top guys that are at the top of their field in sports cars, and then you have the sort of the weekend warriors who come out to race at Daytona just because Daytona is Daytona, and they want to come out there, and they're just, it is just a monumental job on the part of the professional drivers to have to deal with some of these really, in some cases, true amateurs. I mean, that I'm not taking anything against away from the amateur, but they create a whole area of problems. So when you're racing with only professionals, you can assume what they're going to do in any given situation. When you're racing against professionals and amateurs, you never know what the amateur is going to do. So you always have to assume the worst. You can't, these cars today, you can't see inside. You don't know who the hell is driving it. So every car you come up to, you have to treat it with the absolute utmost respect, because you never know who's going to be in it and whether he sees you coming and turn down on you or any number of crazy things that happen.
So we've learned that you drove Buicks, Chevys, and everyone here knows you as a Porsche driver, but did you drive other cars?
Well, I drove Indy cars. That was an opportunity that was given to me by the late Lindsey Hopkins, who was the Coca-Cola bottler in Atlanta. And he had a wonderful, he was just a true gentleman of racing and a passion. And this car was a Lightning chassis, which he developed. This was in 1979. This was right before I was going to go out and qualifying. I think that's Tom Benford with the white hair standing next to me, who was kind of the guy that sort of gave the final briefing to all the drivers before they went out for the qualifying run. We were on a killer lap. We were really cooking, and the motor blew up, so we didn't have enough time to get it.
And then you crossed the channel from Germany, and you drove something else.
This was 79, so right after that we went to Le Mans and ran there. So
Jaguar?
Oh, Jaguars, yeah, Jaguar. Well, that's a whole nother story. That was the Jaguar part was I really had a bad injury in 1983, in August of 83. At Mosport, and I broke my legs really badly, and it was going to be a basically a 2-year healing period before I had enough strength in my leg to push down the clutch. And in a Porsche, you had to use the clutch. So Jaguar called me up and they said, in our cars, we have Huling gearboxes. You don't have to use the clutch, so come drive for us. And this was with Group 44. And I went over with Porsche's permission. Porsche said, yeah, go over there, you know, stay current, and then when your leg gets better, come back. And which is what I did. And it was actually a...
But there was an interim step there.
Well, with Audi, yeah. When Tom Walkinshaw basically took over from the Jaguar Racing worldwide, basically sort of kicked Bob Tullius out, and Joe Hoppen, who ran both Porsche and Audi Racing at that point, called me up and they said, who do you think that we should get to run the team? We're going to bring, the factory's going to bring a team over to the United States, and who do you think we should get? And I said, well, you know, get Bob Tullius. He's just lost the Jaguar deal. He's got the whole operation in place. He just can move in and take off. And that's exactly what we did. And we just completely kicked ass with that car. I won the Trans Am Championship in 88. And then we next year we moved over to GTO. They threw us out of Trans Am with the four-wheel drive. And that was basically a 200 Quattro four-door sedan. And then in 89, we went over to the GTO, which was based off the 90 Quattro. And that was cool.
Hurley, what is quiet time?
Well, quiet time in relationship on the racetrack?
On a racetrack, yeah. I mean, not preschool, but yeah, a racetrack.
You know, I think that picture kind of says it all right there, because... you can imagine a racing car driver's life at the racetrack is pretty hectic. He's got, you know, people pulling him in a million different directions. Everybody wants to shake your hand. Everybody wants to talk to you. And so to get away from that is sometimes really, really difficult to do. And one of the times that I always really left on the table to bring all my thoughts together was this time right here, which is just before the start of the race. The cars have not given the command to start your engines. You're there, the track is being cleared of all the people, and you're able to sort of close your eyes and focus about what you are going to do. And in a racing driver's mind, there's millions of things that go through your mind. You know, am I going to make it through the race? Am I going to hurt myself? Am I going to kill myself? Am I up to the challenge of winning today? So this is a time where the drivers can kind of get all their thoughts together, manage and control those thoughts so you don't make stupid mistakes at the beginning. At the beginning of the race, your adrenaline is pumping, and that is the time when most people make a stupid mistake, is at the beginning of a race. So this is the time where you just sort of focus on what you need to do and then get the job done.
So focusing, bring up a good point. Let's talk about Porsche around the time this car came out. This is around 91. What was going on at Porsche, the company? Let's put aside racing for a minute.
Well, it's pretty... That car kind of represents sort of the whole new chapter from Porsche's standpoint. This was 1991, and Peter had committed suicide in 1980, and his wife of 9 days inherited our dealerships. So Bob Snodgrass was in charge of running the dealerships at that point. And Deborah didn't want to race a Porsche. She was more into muscle cars, so she raced, and Jack Roush was a good friend of hers, so she went off and raced Mustangs. And in 1981, Bob Snodgrass and Dan Davis got together and bought her out And immediately, we started our racing program back. And in 1991, this was the platform that we used in the Supercar Championship, and we won that championship three times running. This also, and back then, you can remember that Porsche's fortunes were not that great in the early 90s. And that had to, that was a factory level program, completely factory funded. And so Dr. Wedeking had to give the okay for that to happen. And luckily he saw the benefit of shining the emblem on a 911, and he approved that project to go through. History, I think, will pretty much confirm that Dr. Wedeking was the guy that really saved Porsche. He brought in the Japanese to come in to analyze his company and, you know, ask them, what would you do to make my company more successful? They gave him a list of things to do, and he followed that list perfectly. And basically, he basically turned the fortunes around with Porsche really overnight, and Porsche became the most profitable automotive company in the world. And it's just, you know, there's a lot of things that kind of, he got sidetracked toward the end of his reign, but the early days, it was all him.
This was back in the day when there was really one model and the 928 was starting to go out, and now as you guys walked in, well, we have a large sedan, we had the Panamera plug-in there, a plug-in Porsche, the now new Macan, and the Cayman sitting outside here.
Yeah, it's pretty remarkable. I mean, Porsche is the kind of company, you know, I've been driving Porsches from 1969, and they have been my partner from the get-go, and without Porsche, I would never have been able to win all the races that I have won. And when you're dealing with a company like that, when they make a commitment to do something, you can pretty much be guaranteed that it's going to be successful. When they first came with the Cayenne project, you know, we closed our eyes and sort of hit our heads and going, what are you guys thinking of? You know, to come in the marketplace with already saturated with SUVs and to build this, it'll never work. Well, we all know that that's not true. That's the number one selling Porsche. Then we dealt with the Panamera, and we said, what are you guys thinking about? And sure enough, that's been a hugely successful car for them. Now we have the Macan, which is a whole different segment to Porsche, and we're hopefully creating a whole new buyer base with that car. It's a fantastic car. It has all the attributes of a Porsche that we have all grown accustomed to.
I'm not saying this just because he's here. He and I drove this car in Willow Springs recently. I knew it would like the way it drove, but the thing blew me away.
Yeah, it's really special, and it looks really cool. So, you know, I think Porsche, you know, the hybrid technology is super. It's just... to be able to be involved with a company that is so dynamic and so forward-thinking, you know, people say, well, you know, when they developed a car like the 918 and the 919, you know, that's hugely costly to Porsche. And is it worth it to do it? Well, yes, it's worth it, because that technology will be amortized over a long period of time with future cars down the pike. So, yes, the upfront cost is great, but it's going to be able to be managed throughout a long time frame of different models that Porsche will bring to the marketplace.
Now, your partnership with Porsche, it's not just racing. You also are kind of an ambassador, which is kind of how we met. You run the Porsche Sport Driving School. You do have a role in some of the communications, and you're somewhat responsible for teaching me how to drive.
Yeah, I've got, you know, I am so lucky because I've been able to
lucky, take, you call it.
Take, well, yeah, I think it's a certain amount of luck is involved in anything you do. And I've been lucky to be able to be smart enough to understand that there's going to be highs and lows in a career, regardless of what you do. And that you have to ride out the low points. If you look at the history of Porsche racing, from the time that I started to current, there's dips and peaks. And when you get panicked, when you get into a slump, and you suddenly change over to somebody else, you're always going to regret it. And so one thing I've always been really adamant about is remaining faithful to the Porsche brand. And that has allowed me to, when I, you know, got out of the racing seat, that I was able to do other things. I'm an owner of Brumos. I run the Porsche Sport Driving School. I'm the chief instructor out there. And I work very closely with the PR department at Porsche. So we're able to take all of these wonderful products and allow the press to come in and experience what these
It's funny you say that.
Well, you know,
Who would like to see the low points of Hurley's career?
Oh God.
Oh God, yes, is right. This is poor Hurley had to teach me how to heel toe.
I wouldn't no. You're not being honest. I would not count that as a low point.
Okay.
That was a challenge, and you rose to the challenge. You know, you were,
shall we see the challenge?
Go ahead.
Shall we go to the tape? You guys want to see this? Here we go. Hopefully you still watch.
How's that for maintenance?
Good.
That was good.
Now squeeze the power. Squeeze it. All right, I want to see a really nice downshift now.
Okay.
All right, brake. Do the downshift. Give me the blip. No blip.
No blip.
No blip.
Failure on the blip.
And down almost zero on the speed, so that wasn't too good.
Okay, we still have work to do.
Still have work to do.
Hard to learn.
Yeah, well, you gotta be patient. If you're not patient, you'll fly right off the racetrack.
I eventually got it after a couple of years, and we're back live. That is your stunning Barber Motorsports Park where you do this.
Yeah, that's a great racetrack that we're really lucky to be able to operate our school on. It's quite safe, and it allows our students to, you know, basically experience a whole smorgasbord of the cars that we have. You know, we have the complete lineup. The only car we
and off road. They do a whole off road school too.
The only car we don't have there is a 918, which obviously is kind of special, but. It's a wonderful program, and I encourage you, if you're thinking about buying a car, a different type of Porsche, come to our school, experience it. You're out here in California, so we are, you know, going to be opening up an experience center right here, just past the airport, and that's going to be a really cool thing. You're going to be able to see Porsche Motorsports headquarters will be there. It's going to be a really slick operation, and you'll be able to run on a little test track to experience all the different electronic apparatus that Porsche puts into these cars, which in my, you know, everybody says to me, well, you know, I like the raw feeling of driving a car. Well, yes, that's great, but if you can make the car safer by putting a system that's extremely passive in its corrections that you're making, everybody makes mistakes, including me, on driving on any given road. And if you have a system that's able to very gently,
you were saying about gentle.
Yeah. So it's Porsche really does a great job of having all of these wonderful systems work in a very passive way that you sometimes the driver doesn't really know that they're working. That's that to me. That's getting their homework done.
Well, speaking of homework, you and I were overdue because that was a 997 GT3. I think you and I need to get out there and do this again in Barber Motorsports Park with a new GT3.
I think
Dave and I are working. Actually, 918. Forget about the GT3. We're going to move right up to the 918. You know what? No, the 919, which is sitting out there, by the way. Oh, so for those of you that are not here in the live audience, you should come next time because we have a 919 hybrid sitting out there right now. Thank you for sending that. See the cool things you get when you hang out with a race car driver? Hurley, so we've established you're kind of like a guru in how to approach life. We've established that you have an incredible title, which you've earned over the years. What do you do to relax?
Well, that's a great picture, Chris Economaki. Those of you that remember Speed Sport News, I'll just comment on this picture for 1 minute, but that's in my 917 at Lime Rock in Rennsport. He wanted a ride, so I took him for a ride, and you can imagine there's no seats, no seat belt in a 917 at Lime Rock. It's a pretty scary thing. And we get finished after three laps, and we come in. He's kind of breathing hard, and I'm kind of worried about him. We get his helmet off, and I turn to him, and I say, well, how was it? And he goes, well, you're not Juan Fangio, that's for sure. So anyway, Paul Newman, that's another guy that I had an immense...
It's good to be you, man. It really is.
Immense respect for. He was really kind of the actors. And I think that Patrick Dempsey kind of wants to follow in Paul's footsteps. Paul was a really great race driver, and Paul didn't start his racing career until he was, in his mid-40s. So, he was really special. And guys like that who have the fame that they have from making movies, when they attach themselves to a racing series or a manufacturer, it's really, really great for the manufacturer. In Patrick's case, it's Porsche. So I'm thankful that he's racing with Porsche, because if he wasn't, I wouldn't be coaching him, that's for sure.
And what's this?
And that's our dealership in Jacksonville, Brumos Porsche. That's where it kind of all started for me. And that's been, my home. My first check from Brumos came when I was in college, 1967, Peter said, will you drive a 911S to Tampa for delivery? And I looked at him and he said, are you serious? And he said, yeah. And he said, don't wreck it and, vary the RPM and then come home on the bus. So I went and got a check for $50. So that was my first
not check. A bad investment.
Yeah. So
actually there is a tie, a little known tie from this museum to, speaking of home in Florida, the one of the main directors for a very long time of this establishment, the Petersen Automotive Museum, has a relationship with you somehow. How is that?
Yeah, that was pretty unique. I lived in Ponte Vedra on the beach, had a great home there. And I put it on the market sort of right when the market took a dump. And at the same time, right before I put the house on the market, I bought a beautiful lot down in St. Augustine, Florida. And so I was financially miserly with my money, and I didn't want to start a house until I sold the house in Ponte Vedra. So basically, I had to wait a long time. It just, was sitting there, and nobody was looking at it, or people would look at it and not decide not to buy it. And Bill Warner, who runs the Amelia Island Concourse, is a great friend of mine. And Dick Messer, who was the curator here at this museum for many, many
years. He was a director.
Director, yeah.
Director. Dick, can you stand up? Big round of applause for Dick. He's right back there. And Dick's boss, Joanne. Stand up, Joanne.
So Bill said, let me talk to my friend, and they would like to come down and take a look at your house. And Dick and Joanne came down, and they said, yeah, we love this place, we'll buy it. And it was just boom, boom, boom. And so it's been really cool. I love that house, and Joanne and Dick and I stay together when they come back and forth between Jacksonville and here. So it's a really cool thing to be able to have.
Incredibly small world.
Yeah.
And incredibly small world.
It is a small world. Yeah.
Now back to this question of how do you relax? How does the most winning long-distance race car driver relax?
Well, there's a couple things I do. I love sports. So, you know, I play tennis, even though I got kind of a screwed-up leg, so it's kind of comical to watch me bounce around the tennis court. But I'm pretty good at it. And I fish. I like fishing and boating. So I like, you know, things that go on in the water. I have a paddleboard. I have a kayak. I have a boat. So I like all that stuff. And the one thing that most people don't know, and that I share this passion and this love with another very famous racing driver named Jackie X. And Jackie was at a Rennsport at Daytona a couple years ago, and we were talking, and he said, you know, I just can't wait to get back to my garden. And I said, what do you mean? What do you mean by that? And he said, I just love working in the dirt and growing things, whether it be flowers, vegetables, whatever. I just like sticking my hands in the dirt and making things grow. And basically, I'm the same way. I like cooking, and I grow a lot of the stuff that I cook with, herbs and, you know, vegetables and fruits. And so I like the concept of being able to take my hands into dirt and plant something, and then watch that plant grow over whatever, a couple months, and water it and tend it and till the earth. And, you know, I think that kind of love for the land came from my days at living on the farm. We had beef, dairy, a crop, and so I was sort of immersed in all of the different fundamentals of farming, and I kind of like that, and it's what I do now. So,
and with that, I want to say thank you for Hurley to join us here.
Thank you for having me.
Did I not tell you we'd learn some new ways to approach life today? I don't know if we're going to all go out and do gardening from now on, but I think we're all going to be more methodical.
It's very therapeutic.
I'm going to ask my not-so-attractive assistant over here, Adam, to collect some of your question cards if you have some question cards. But while we're doing that, let's go through some housekeeping items, Hurley. I don't know how many of you guys have been following lately, but the show now, our weekly show, is now twice a week. Hurley, did you know that? We're actually twice a week now instead of once a week the past 4 or 5 years. Matter of fact, we've had some great episodes recently up. Hurley and I just drove the new Macan at Willow Springs. Of course, he gave me a hot lap and he scared the crap out of me, but that was beside the point. We've had the new Hellcat with Ralph Giel. And even, you know, if how many of you guys know about CarPlay, the Apple CarPlay system, that your iOS in your car? We actually have driven that in a real live car and played with it, the new Hyundai Sonata. So definitely check that stuff out. We're now twice a week, so make sure you guys come and join us. Our next guest, we're going to continue the racing theme, somewhat of a crazy man here in generations of racing family. We're going to have Reese Millen join us here at the Petersen on October 4th, Saturday, October 4th. Make sure you join us there. And of course, we always ask you to follow us, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, MotoManTV, all one word, MotoManTV, all one word, and the Petersen Museum, Petersen Museum, or Petersen Museum, Petersen _ Museum at Twitter. And with that, I want to move to some of your questions. I'd like to start with an international question, Hurley. We have a question, believe it or not, from Russia, and it's from Vlad J. Suki. And Blad J asks, what is your favorite corner or section of Circuit de la Sarthe?
The favorite set of corners is the Porsche curves. They're very fast. They're very technical. You have to be really perfect to get through there and keep your speed up. So I think, you know, Le Mans is a kind of, you know, it's got 8 miles circuit there, and it's very fast. Before they put the chicanes in, we would do, you know, 240 plus down the Mulsanne straight. And then they put the chicanes in, it's kind of ruined it a little bit, but you still get, you know, well up over 200 between the chicanes. So it's, but that's not really fun. That's just kind of sitting there waiting for something to happen. But, you know, the rest of the average speed there is really quite high. You know, it's 165 miles an hour, I think, or something like that. And but the set of corners that gives me the biggest rush is the Porsche curves. So, Porsche curves.
Okay. My fellow Greek brother, Tom Gatsoulis, he asks a great question. Who did you enjoy racing against the most?
Well, that's easy. I think that the guy I really loved racing against was Al Hobart. Al Hobart was both the teammate on most of the factory rides that I was in, and then he was also a fierce competitor. So I knew Al, you know, in his hell racing days. I mean, he was really a party animal, and then, you know, he changed over. Christianity took over, and he was. It's kind of changed his whole life, but it didn't change how he was in a race car, and he was just
had a co-pilot,
you know, mean as he could be, but he was just a really great guy to race with, because he knew that he never was going to do something that was going to cause you to have an incident.
Okay, Sean asks a very good question. I believe it's Sean Neo. Between Vasek. And hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly. Between Vasek and Peter, who was the best owner and hardest to deal with?
Well, Vasek never was an owner of a car that I drove for.
Yeah.
He was an owner. He owned a racing team. But I never actually drove for Vasek other than, I think I drove in the Trans Am for him one season in a 911. But Vasek was a great guy. I mean, I just loved him as a person, but it was either Vasek's way or no way. And some of his things that he thought about and did were just way out there.
Peter wasn't like that as well?
No. Well, no, Peter, there was always logic to Peter's, the way that he approached a project or a problem. But sometimes the logic with Vasek was just way out there. You couldn't grasp where he was going with it. But he was a great guy. I loved Vasek. He was so proud of what he did. He came to this country with, you know, 2 cents in his pocket, and basically he ended up owning Hermosa Beach. And one of the
that he does. I mean, they're still down there, basically.
Yeah, one of the most successful Porsche dealerships in the country. So, but, you know, I loved driving for Peter. But, you know, from a driver's standpoint, if you had to take about a team owner that was able to get the best out of me as a racing driver, Bob Tullius was a guy that...
Really?
Yeah. He was a master of being able to push just so far so he wouldn't piss you off, but he would get you to operate at your best, and he was really good at that. I think that was from his military days.
Big theme with the military with you guys.
Yeah, he was. Say that again.
Big theme with the military with you guys.
Yeah, well,
Peter, yeah. Bob, you.
I mean, I didn't really enjoy my time in the military, but it was. Yeah, there's a lot of
benefits
to military life and how you structure things. But you know, Bob was able to push just hard enough to get the best without pushing you over the line.
Yeah. Brian asks a great question. Favorite race car and track, and why?
The last question first. The favorite track is Watkins Glen. I love Watkins Glen. That was my first racetrack that I won a race at, professional race. I stayed in the same hotel, slept in the same room since 1969. The folks that own the place I stay with are just like family. They really are great. So I always love going back there. As far as the race car, there's so many great race cars, but if I had to choose one car that I love driving the most, it would be the 936. That was the open cockpit car I won first time at Le Mans with in 77. And then we drove it two times since then, and the last permeation of that car was 81, which was the Jules car, and that had the Porsche engine, Porsche Indy engine in it. And that was just a sweetheart to drive. Just the right balance of performance and road holding and just the ease. And I like open cockpit cars. So that car.
And just so the folks here know, you guys have a museum at Brumos of some of your cars.
Yeah, we have a museum that we're really proud of. We've been able to capture back most of the significant race cars that I've driven over the years.
Yeah, Vasek made a lot of money on the deal, didn't he?
Yeah. So we've got a little bit of everything in there. So
Richard asks a good question. I would say Richard is probably a long-distance runner by some of these questions. Do you sleep before an endurance race? How do you get protein, and how do you hydrate?
Well, yes, I do sleep before the race. And during the race, sometimes, that when we, take a break, it's kind of like a light switch. I just turn the switch off and I can go back to, sleeping. But we've have really defined that, the art of keeping our drivers in 100%. In the early days, I used to really get dehydrated in a racing car. And sometimes, especially at Le Mans, they would keep you in the cars for long periods of time. And when you would get, and they had no drink bottle, they had no air conditioning suits, you just, lost all the fluid. And then when you get into that state, to recover is almost impossible. You cannot You cannot drink enough fluid to get back into it. So I brought my own doctor over with me a couple times, and he hydrated me with an intravenous drip,
with a
saline solution, and they would
put in that, the car.
No, not in the car. Out of the car. No, not in the car. Out of the car, but it's about a 20-minute procedure. Mm. It gets the fluid back into your system very efficiently.
Your electrolytes back up.
Everything goes up. You're able to get back in the car in basically an hour from being completely wasted. We back up that process by using a hyperbaric chamber, which is pressure under oxygen under pressure at 14 pounds, I think. So you get in this big cigar-looking thing. They zip the thing closed. They pressurize it. You breathe oxygen, and you spend about 40 minutes in that. It's like 40 minutes in the chamber is like 4 hours of deep sleep, and that takes the hydration that you put into your body and saturates the cell structure quicker. So it's a really efficient way to do
this
it.
This is racing or Star Trek?
Yeah, this is racing. And we brought that system on board maybe, 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And Tony Stewart, who saw us doing it, and he thought it was the funniest thing in the world. And he wanted to try it. So he got in there, he tried it. And he came out and he says, man, I am like a new person. This was during the 24 hours race. So he took it to the 500, used it at the 500. And the next race, Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon had it. And then everybody's got them now. So everybody in NASCAR uses those in the you know 500 mile or 600 mile races.
I mean, I'm a question for me, but so we found out you have a NASCAR license. Have you ever driven a NASCAR?
Yeah, I drove. Yeah, not very successfully. I ran in IROC, which is the International Race of Champions, mm-hmm. 4 times. So that was always a great thrill to be able to, you know, race against those guys. I remember racing against Dale Earnhardt, and you know, just a really unique experience.
Well, you're a good old Southern boy now.
Yeah, well, and Dale had sympathy for me. He kind of taught me where those envelopes of opportunity happen in the draft. You know, yeah. where to split the draft.
Yeah.
To make it work. So, but those guys, I mean, yeah. Those stock car guys stick together, and they take the outside group, and they shovel us back before we know what's happening. So.
Which brings us to our last question from Alex, which is somewhat related. Which race did you have to overcome the most adversity to win? Good question, Alex.
Oh, I mean, every race has got, you know, problems that you have to overcome. I think the 77 Daytona win was probably the biggest challenge for me because my co-drivers that were driving with me in that race, they owned the car, but they were sort of amateur guys. They weren't pros. And everything was going great. And this was the first year that the turbocharged cars were coming online, and I had elected not to drive a turbocharged car. It was a normally aspirated RSR. And so we qualified way the hell back, but we were confident. And then nightfall was coming, and these guys came up to me and said, you know, we don't really like to drive at night. We want you to drive at night. I said, what are you talking about? You got to drive at night. And I said, no, you do it. You last as long as you can. So I ended up driving an 8-hour shift at night. And I would make the come in for the pit stop, jump out of the car, and they had this little enclosure that they had made with blankets, and I would go in and I would change helmets and then, you know, fly back out. Well, the IMSA guys knew what was going on, but I wasn't making a complete idiot myself. And yeah. we were coming up the leaderboard because the turbocharged cars were having problems, and we ended up winning the race. But that race, after the race was over, that was truly one of the races I was just exhausted. I mean, I hardly could stand up. I was so tired. But that just goes to show you that when you push your body to points where you just didn't think it's possible, mm-hmm. To get motivated, I keep looking at the leaderboard every lap I would come by, and we kept going up and up and on the leaderboard, so that was enough incentive to keep on going. So that had a lot of challenges. That was probably the most challenging.
And with that, a big round of applause for the most winning long-distance race car driver in the world.
Thank you.
For our live audience here in the museum, we're going to be doing an autograph session downstairs in front of the bookstore. For those of you that have joined us from all over the world, thank you for joining us once again at the Petersen Automotive Museum. We ask you to follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all of your social channels for future schedules. And make sure you join us on Saturday, October 4th for Reese Millen. And with that, I want to say thank you again, Hurley, for joining us. It's really a fantastic journey, and I'm happy to call you a friend for all these years.